Om Namah Shivaya, I'm Sanchita Roy. Welcome to class 12 biology class. Today I'm going to discuss the 13th chapter, Organisms and Populations, part 5. In my previous video, I have been discussing how an individual is reacting in the environment in which it lives, that is the habitat in which it lives, how it adjusts and how it copes up. And then I have discussed about different abiotic factors which is responsible for the distribution of the individuals or population in a particular area. Then in the other videos I have discussed about the different attributes of the population. Then I have discussed about the different types of population growth curve, that is the exponential and the logistic growth curve. Today in this video, I am going to discuss about the different types of interactions between the individuals, between the populations, how the individuals are interacting with the other groups of animals. Over here, we are going to see about the biotic interaction. In the previous videos, we have discussed about the interaction with the abiotic factors to cope up with the different types of temperature, water availability, soil type, light type. Organisms shows different types, individuals shows different types of adaptations. But today I'm going to discuss here about how the organisms adapt themselves to protect themselves from the different types of biotic components which are present around them in their habitat. Population interaction. You can see that if we know that all the living organisms are interdependent. We are interdependent upon each another for different activities, for different purposes. No organism can survive alone on this earth. It is impossible for an organism to survive alone. For example, plants. Yes, we know that we are basically dependent upon the plants for our energy, for the source of energy. But aren't the plants dependent upon the animals or the groups of insects or something? Yes, plants are also dependent upon the other organisms. For example, why? In case of the plants, the pollination. The pollination is taken place by the help of insect. Large amount of insects help in the process of pollination. Different plants are getting pollinated by other animals also. Animals like birds also play an important role in the process of pollination. If pollination is not taking place, then the plants cannot reproduce. They won't be able to produce seeds, so they won't be able to produce the new plants. So plants also depend upon, again, the plants are taking nutrients from the soil. From where the plants are getting the nutrients? It is the microbes which are responsible in converting or decomposing the dead organisms, and the microorganisms helps in providing the nutrients to the plants. And animals, we are directly or indirectly dependent upon the plants and the other groups of animals. Like you can see over here, the herbivores, they are dependent upon the producers, upon the plants. On the other hand, the herbivores are eaten up by the carnivores. So you can see that each of the organisms are interdependent upon each another. Over here you can see another type of interaction. The fish is hiding itself inside the porifers. Now what is that? It is actually getting protection from the other organism. So different over here, you can see on the body of the fish, there are certain barnacles are growing. What is there? There is an interaction between two organisms. It is providing shelter. Over here, you can see on the body of the rhinoceros, there are certain animals, certain birds are sitting. So what is that? These are an interdependence upon each another of the different types of organisms. Now let us see what is written over here. Can you think of any natural habitat on earth that is inhabited just by a single species? There is no such habitat, and such a situation is even inconceivable. For any species, the minimum requirement is one more species on which it can feed. So always we will see that there will be minimum two groups of organisms. Even a plant species which makes its own food cannot survive alone, just as I said. It needs soil microbes to break down the organic matter in soil and return the inorganic nutrients for absorption. And then how will the plant manage pollination without an animal agent? It is obvious that in nature, animals, plants, and microbes do not and cannot live in isolation, but interact in various ways to form a biological community. Even in minimum commodities, many interactive linkages exist, although all may not be readily apparent. Interspecific interactions arise from the interaction of the population. So, interspecific interaction is taking place among the different populations of different species. They can be beneficial, detrimental, or neutral to one of the species or both. So, the interaction can be what it can be beneficial, both the organisms can be getting benefited from one another, or it may be harmful for the other and the other might be benefited, or it might be neutral. No one is getting harmed by it, but they are dependent upon each another. So depending upon the type of interaction between the organisms, we can broadly categorize them. The interaction of the organisms can be broadly categorized into five types. What are the five types? They are predation, competition, parasitism, commensalism, and mutualism. Let us see what are the types of interactions. Mutualism, what we will see, if we consider two organisms, they are interdependent upon each another. But what they are doing, both of them are getting benefited. Nobody is getting any harm over here. Both the species benefit from the interaction in case of mutualism. Commensalism, over here one is getting benefited and the other is not getting harmed. It is having no role in the other organism. So one species benefits, one unaffected. It is harmless for the other organism. Neutralism, neutralism is what? Over here no harm, no benefit is being taking place. Population do not affect one another. Though they are interacting among each another, but both of them are not playing any role in it. Okay? Amensalism. Amensalism is what? The one organism, one species is unaffected, one is disadvantaged. One organism who is lying on, one organism is remaining unaffected, whereas, but because of the presence of this other organism, it is getting, the other one is getting affected. It is causing some problem. Over here, what is there? Amensalism and mutualism, in commensalism. Commensalism is one is getting benefited, the other is neutral. Over here in amensalism, one is not getting, it's neutral. The one of the organism is not getting affected, but the other organism is getting affected due to the presence of this organism. Predation and parasitism. One is getting affected, the other is getting unaffected. So, because of this predation, for example, a tiger is eating a deer. Tiger is benefited, whereas the deer is getting affected. Parasitism also, the parasite and the host. The parasite is getting benefited. For example, Ascaris. It is getting benefited as a parasite, whereas it is causing harm to the host. So this is one species benefits, one is in disadvantage. Competition, both are getting affected. Each species affected negatively. Both can get destroyed because of the over competition among the interspecific organisms. So these are the different types of interactions which we can see among the interspecific organisms. So in this video I'm going to discuss one of these. One is called the predation. What is predation? It is an interspecific interaction where one animal kills and consumes the other weaker animal. Very simple definition. A tiger is eating a deer. Over here, tiger is the predator and the deer is the prey. So it is an interspecific tiger deer. They belong to different species. Interspecific interaction when one animal kills and consumes the other weaker animal. The next is the roles of the predators. Transfer, what is the role of the predator? They help in transfer of energy from the plants to the higher trophic levels. Position of organisms in the food chain. The next is the control of prey population. The population of the prey will be in a control. Prickly pear, cactus, moth. Biological control of the agricultural pest. This is the prickly pear moth, which played a very important role in Australia in killing the cactus. The cactus was grown in Australia and they grew so massively, it created a havoc over there because of their fast process of reproduction. They undergo the asexual mode of reproduction and due to that, they started growing massively. They were uncontrollable, but later on, the prickly pear cactus moth was introduced in Australia and they helped in reducing the growth. So they help in controlling the prey population because this cactus was growing uncontrollably. Maintain species diversity by reducing intensity of competition among the competing prey species. Because there is a continuous competition between the intraspecific also. But because of the presence of the predators, the intraspecific competition can also be reduced. Overexploitation of the prey by the predators results in extinction of the prey and predator. For example, if the carnivore, if the tiger starts eating massively all the deer, then what will happen? Soon the population of the deer will get finished, and if their food is getting finished, what is going to happen? It will gradually affect the predator also. It will affect the tiger also because the tiger won't be able to get enough amount of food. So what is there? Overexploitation of the prey. If the predator feeds upon the prey too much, then what will happen? The prey will get get finished over there, and because of that the predator won't get the food enough. Defense to lessen impact of the predation. There are different defense mechanisms adopted by the organisms to protect themselves from the predation. What are the different mechanisms? Like insects and frog, they camouflage. Butterfly, monarch butterfly, they become very poisonous, they become so tasteless that their predators do not like to feed them. You can see over here how this frog is getting predation over there. This is a Venus flytrap. Okay, this Venus flytrap, it can not only trap the insects, it can also trap the animals also, like smaller animals like frogs. What will happen? These leaves will gradually close up and they will extract the nutrients available in these animals. So in this way, even the plants are having mechanisms by which they can consume the necessary organisms. So you can see the examples of different types of predators. The insect is feeding upon the leaves. So the insect is a predator on the leaves. Okay. So these are the few examples of the predators and their prey. Over here, the predators also help in maintaining species diversity in a community. By reducing the intensity of the competition among the competing prey species. Just now in the previous slide, I have told you that the intraspecific, that is the competition between the organisms of the same species can be reduced by the effect of the predators. Over here the example, in the exam it is very important, they cite the examples and they ask you what type of interaction can you see in this type of organisms. So in the rocky intertidal communities of the American Pacific coast, the starfish Pisister is an important predator. In a field experiment, when all the starfish were removed from an exposed intertidal area, more than 10 species of the invertebrates became extinct. Starfish was removed from the intertidal spaces of the American Pacific coast, and then it was found that within a short span of time, 10 species of the invertebrates became extinct within a year because of interspecific competition. They were a predator and they restricted the competition. Because of their absence, what happens? The population of the different invertebrates increased rapidly and they started fighting among themselves. They started competing among themselves. As a result, what happened? The 10 types of 10 different species of invertebrates became extinct just within a period of 1 year. So the predator also helps in maintaining the species diversity, maintaining the diversity of the organism in a particular habitat. If a predator is not efficient and overexploit its prey, then the prey might become extinct, and following it, the predator will also become extinct for lack of food. For example, as I just said at the very beginning, if the population of the deer gets finished due to some reason, then what will happen? The carnivores will not get the food. Similarly, if there is no carnivore, then what can happen? The population of the herbivore in that forest area can increase. For example, the population of the deer can increase rapidly. If the population of the deer increases rapidly, what can happen? They will start eating upon the more of the plants, because of which the plants population can become decreased in that particular habitat. This is the reason why predators in nature are prudent. Prey species have evolved various defenses to lessen the impact of predation. So it is not always the predators will have the benefit. Even the preys are adopted in such a way that they can protect themselves from the predators. Over here you can see that how the frog has camouflaged itself. Their body color is in such a way that they are getting hidden around their surroundings. The predator cannot identify the presence of the prey in this directly. For example, a frog is eaten by a snake. A snake, it will be difficult for the snake to identify whether the frog is present over there or not, because it is totally getting camouflaged with its surrounding. So, some species of the insects and frogs are cryptically colored, that is, they camouflage them to avoid being detected easily by the predators. Some are poisonous and therefore avoided by the predators. Again, some of the organisms are having certain chemicals which are very tasteful or which can be harmful for the predators. So in this way, the prey can protect themselves from the predators. The monarch butterfly is highly distasteful to its predator. When a predator feeds upon these monarch butterfly, it is highly tasteless. And because of that, they are having certain chemicals which they acquire during the larval stage. And when the other organism feeds upon the monarch butterfly, it is so tasteless that they do not keep on eating. So the population of the monarch fly can keep on growing without the fear of the predators. Over here for plants, herbivores are the predators. In case of the plants, we can see the another different types of adaptations they have developed.
to protect themselves from their predators. For example, we can see that 25% of all insects are known to be phytophagous. That means they feed upon the plant part for their requirement. So feeding on the plant sap and the other parts of the plants, we can see that the insects are feeding upon the sap, that is the fluid which is present inside the stem parts. Okay, so they feed upon the sap. Or what else, that they can be other parts, they can develop the, so the plants develop different types of mechanisms to protect themselves from the effect of the different insects. So what are, how they are adopted? Plants therefore have evolved an astonishing variety of morphological and chemical defenses against herbivores. Over here in case of acacia, you can see what is there, they are having very hard and strong thorns. These thorns protect the plant from being eaten up by the herbivores. The herbivores will not take an attempt to eat these type of acacia plants because these thorns will harm, they will cause damage to the body, to the mouth parts of the herbivores. So in this way, the plants have developed some mechanisms to protect themselves from the predators. That means so that the predators, the herbivorous animals, will not come and eat upon them. On the other hand, there are certain plants, they also produce certain chemicals, like in case of the calotropis. You can see that this type of plants, where the plants are very less, but we can see these plants are growing well in certain abundant areas. How or why doesn't the cattle feed upon them? The cattle do not feed upon the calotropis because the calotropis are containing certain chemicals which are very poisonous. They are called the poisonous cardiac glycosidase. This type of chemical is being accumulated in the body of the calotropis. When consumed by the cattle, it can cause cardiac problems in the cattle. So these type of chemicals, the harmful toxic chemicals, are produced by the plant to protect themselves from the herbivorous animals. A wide variety of chemical substances that we extract from the plants on a commercial scale, like nicotine, caffeine, quinine, strychnine, opium, these are the different chemical substances produced by the plants for as a defense mechanism. But again, we human beings have tried to extract the benefits of these chemical substances are produced by them actually as defense against grazers and browsers. So this is how the different organisms, the prey and the predator, are adopted to obtain their food. The way the predators are having developed their adaptations. For example, if you take the tiger, they are having a special adaptations to so that they can feed upon the animals. On their forelimbs, they are having claws. These claws help in holding the animals and causing damage. You can see the carnivores. In case of the tiger, their canines are so developed, they are so big that it helps in tearing the flesh from the body of their prey. So the adaptation, the way the predators are adopted, similarly what is that, the prey is also adopted in different ways so that it can protect itself from the predators. So over here I will end it over here. Next I will be discussing the other interactions in my next video. Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.